Joining us is Howie Klein. He's the founder and treasurer of the Blue America PAC. They raise money for progressive and some socialist candidates. You must read him every day over at Down With Tyranny. Lots to talk about, but first, Rick Ocasek.
Oh, sad, very sad. So Rick died yesterday. He was, or the day before, he was 75, young guy. But Rick had a really important role in my life, not just because I liked his music, but because I was had a struggling little tiny independent label. And we had just put out an album by a band called Romeo Void. And wow. They were on tour.
I didn't know you were with Romeo. Go ahead.
Yeah. Well, Romeo Void was the first band that I ever actually signed. Before that, we put bands out, but we didn't sign deals with them. And then one of them screwed me over, and I realized I had to actually sign a contract. So Romeo Void was the first band we signed a contract with. And we had their first album out, and they were on the road touring. And Rick saw them at a club in Boston. And in Boston, that was a good spot for Romeo Void because WBCN, the big rock station there, was playing their music. So that's why he went to the show. He loved them, and he said, why don't we – and he heard a song that they performed that wasn't on the album. And he said, why don't I take you into the studio at my expense, and I'll produce that record for you. And he did, and the song was Never Say Never, and it was the big hit. It's the biggest hit that they had – certainly till then. And it really sort of got my whole shtick in the record business going in a big way, because immediately lots of record companies, major labels, started calling me and saying, hey, we'd like to do a deal with you.
Wow.
Or we'd like to buy Romeo Void's contract, some of them said. And because of that, I wound up doing a deal, unfortunately, with Sony, but it still, you know, made me go from someone who was very poor and didn't have, like I've always say, I'd always have to choose between putting gas in my car or eating, which reminds me of something funny that happened today. Some Trump guy on Twitter started carrying on. I don't know this guy. I've never seen his name before. And he said, he started denouncing me and saying that I call him some kind of a hick or something like that, and denigrate him, and he's poor, and he was born poor, and I was born rich, and he's just going on and on. I'm thinking, who the hell is this guy? He had everything wrong. I was born poor also. And I tweeted him back and said, dude, I don't know you. I think you got me mixed up with somebody else. And then he wrote back to me, and he knew it. He didn't tell me anything about him. He told me a lot about me, some of which was right, some of which was wrong, all of which is publicly available information. But it's kind of a weird situation. It's strange. And then, you know, so I don't know, 50 Trump people retweeted him. So it's, you know, been annoying me all day. Not annoying me a lot, just annoying me a little. Not annoying me as much as when Twitter kicked me off for 12 hours. Did you see that?
No.
Yes, I answered back Trump in a way that is against the rules. I didn't realize. I haven't read the rules. I guess I should. But he said something about, what he tweeted over the weekend was very stable genius. Referring to himself. And I responded in a way that I didn't realize was against the rules, but is. I responded by saying, I hope we see that on your tombstone very soon.
Ooh, ooh, ooh.
I mean, I didn't say I want to kill him or anything like that.
Right.
But I guess that it still doesn't matter because they then cut my service off, and then they gave me a couple of choices of how to get back on. The short way to get back on in 12 hours would be to give them my my unlisted cell phone number and voluntarily delete the tweet.
Right.
So you had to do that, and then you get out for 12 hours, or you could appeal their ruling, and then you're off until they make up their mind, which they don't know how long that's going to take. But it sounded to me like a month.
Right.
Twitter's, so I decided.
Yeah. So
I just decided to give them my phone number and voluntarily delete the tweet.
Right. I should mention that if you have questions for Howie Klein. Oh, I'm sorry. Let me just say something to the listeners. We have a new button over at DavidFeldmanShow.com. Ask me anything. If you have any questions for Howie Klein that you want me to ask Howie on the show, the quickest way to get to Howie through me is to hit the Ask Me Anything button. A lot of people have questions for you, and sometimes
I love that button. Yeah. That's so awesome.
Yeah, yeah. Go ahead.
There was a new rule that they just promulgated this weekend, which I think is really, really terrible, and they should reconsider it. And I did tweet that they should reconsider it. And it's that they've abolished the idea of using a hashtag to denigrate a politician. So you can denigrate other people, but just not a politician. Like you could denigrate an artist, for example, but not a politician. And I'm thinking this is the opposite of Americanism. I mean, politicians were supposed to be allowed to denigrate. This is outrageous.
Right.
But it was because of Mitch McConnell. He went so nuts over being called Moscow Mitch, hashtag Moscow Mitch, that he kind of forced them into doing this.
Really? Really?
Yeah. I mean, it's just shocking to me that they would do something like this. So now if you go hashtag Moscow Mitch or hashtag, you know, Trump's a bitch or any of that stuff, you, if they catch you, you get suspended.
Wow. Rick Ocasek, before we move on, he had a generous spirit as he got older. He began producing other artists. Can you be...
He was quite young at the time.
I'm sorry?
And he produced a lot of really good songs for people. I don't know if you remember this band Suicide, but they had a record out called... they had a bunch of records out, but the best one and the one that got them the most attention was called Dream Baby Dream, which is just fantastic. And you can find that on YouTube. I don't mean just you, David, but I mean anyone who's listening to us can go to YouTube and look up Suicide Dream Baby Dream. And that was just an incredible song. I used to play it all the time when I was a DJ. I couldn't get enough of it.
These music.
But he did a lot of music for a lot of unknown bands. And there was never any case where he did it to make money. He always did it, as you said, he was a generous spirit, and he did it for free. In fact, better than doing it for free, he did it at his own cost. He would pay the cost of doing these things, as he did for me with Romeo Void, which was fantastic of him. And, you know, a debt that I could never pay back, even if he was living.
Right. If you had advice to young musicians, it seems that the really successful rock stars or whomever have 10 really productive years and then they kind of recede. Is that because they want to recede or they get lazy?
No, they're desperate not to recede. I have it even differently than that. Although there are, don't try to find examples where I'm wrong, because there are plenty of them. This is just a general thing that's not always right. In fact, sometimes it's completely wrong. But just in a general sense, band's first album is usually their best album. Now, there are definitely cases where that's not the case. But the way I always used to see it was that a band can spend years and years and years, even before they're a band, writing those songs for the first album, and then the first album comes out and they've got to do another one really quick. They get all these pressures, we've got to have the songs in 4 months or something like that. And then very frequently they wind up in a situation where some of the creative juices get killed, where producers come in and record companies come in and all sorts of pressures come in, and the band has to be commercial. And then they have a big team that they're supporting they become a corporation in some ways, and everything changes. But there are so many instances of bands whose first album is their best album, and then it's downhill after that. Some of them gently downhill and some of them precipitously downhill.
Elton John, big story about the influence that he has over Donald Trump, was in the New York Times. Now, Elton John played at Rush Limbaugh's third marriage ceremony. he played at Donald Trump's wedding with Melania. What obligation does Elton John have to start writing songs that say, F you, Donald Trump? Because he's got a big influence. Apparently, Donald Trump blasts Elton John music at his rallies and on the private jet when he's flying to the rallies?
Elton John do anything like that? Elton John is a aristocratic, elitist queen who probably, you know, is fine with sucking up to others in his own perceived class. I knew Elton when he was very, very young. We were both very, very young at the time. And I was living in Amsterdam, and and one of my friends in Amsterdam, his boyfriend owned a big travel agency in London, and his own planes, not plane, but planes and villas all over Europe. And he was so in love with that friend of mine that he used to let him and his friends, which included me, fly around Europe in the off season and use his villas. Wow. And I got, you know, free planes all over the place and free villa usage all over the place. And it was pretty fantastic. And then, but part of the deal was we'd have to go to his house so he could be with my friend John. And one of this guy's other friends was Elton John, at the time unknown and no recording deal, but a musician, also David Bowie at the same time. So I got to meet those guys before they were known at all. And I liked David Bowie a lot, and I didn't like Elton John at all, who subsequently, I never had any business dealings with him, but he was always seems to become friends with like creepy people. One guy who I worked for at one time who was kind of the same way, like a real suck up to rich elitist types. He and Elton became very close friends.
So his So his politics, other than AIDS, he's done a lot for AIDS, but his
that's the right thing. AIDS is, you know, AIDS is a health issue, and especially for a gay person. You know what I think about people who stay in the closet for too long in their lives, something gets rotten about them. And he's a good example of that. He had to be dragged out of the closet, you know, decades after everyone in the world knew he was gay. Right. It's not fair to me. You know, like, I don't really know the guy. You know, I knew him a little bit when I was much younger, and he was, you know, we were both teenagers or 20 something, 20 or 21, 22, but he never impressed me much. And the fact that he played at Elton John's wedding and Rush Limbaugh's wedding, I mean, shouldn't that just tell you who he is and what he is?
Right.
And the idea of expecting him to denounce Trump is insane. Why would he?
Right.
It's more likely that he would sing a song about the greatness of Donald.
Okay. So
instead of Daniel, he'd do it about Donald.
Yeah. Yeah. The debates. I haven't talked to you since Thursday's debate. Would you be willing to concede? Well, first of all, I was wrong. I have to say I was wrong. I said Biden was going to drop out or suspend the campaign after last week.
I mean, that was crazy. I didn't take you seriously when you said it.
Oh, I was convinced. But I thought that was his best performance. And it was pretty horrible. But that's the best he's done so far.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, I think as the debate went on, he got tireder and tireder and less able to give a coherent answer to anything.
Mm-hmm.
But, yeah, I mean, you know, he's a pro. This is his life's work. He knows how to do these things. I don't know. I thought he was awful. I thought Elizabeth Warren and Bernie were both great.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I like some of the other stuff, but that people did. I thought, although I know everybody else doesn't agree with me, I thought that, Julian Castro did well.
Go on.
I thought Andrew Yang was a dud, that, you know, history making nonsense that he had tried to rev the audience up with. That was like silly.
Julian Castro not out of line?
Well, he's just being truthful. What's to be out of line?
Well, if somebody gets upset, there's some truth to it. In other words, if you asked me if I'm getting forgetful, I am, but that's not an issue in my life. The early onslaught of senility is an issue with Joe Biden. So when he said that, it struck a nerve and everybody rallied to Joe Biden's support over this.
He did. Like, I didn't.
Well, but it suggests that if everybody thought it was inappropriate, it means that we have to worry about Joe Biden's memory, because it was hurtful for him to call him on a disability. Obviously, it's a disability, right?
Yeah, but, you know, we're talking about electing a president, and if a president is senile or incipient senility is encroaching on his abilities, that has to be talked about. I mean, you know, my biggest fear is that we're going to wind up with Biden and Trump running against each other, and the two issues are going to be which one lies the most and which one is more senile.
Right. Now, it turns out, at least the mainstream media is saying that Julian Castro was wrong for what he was, that Biden had been consistent on his health care plan, and Julian Castro,
Julian,
whatever, was wrong about that, factually wrong.
There's some debate about that.
Yeah, I figured as much. And then when he looked to Bernie, that moment when Biden looked to Bernie like, what, huh? Like, you're my age. Am I losing? He should not be running.
That's what's horrible about this. It's not really about age. You know, Bernie is even a little older than him, but Bernie is in control of his facilities. Trump is a little bit younger than Biden, and Trump is probably in worse situation cognitively than Biden is. To say it's about age is uncomfortable. It's uncomfortable for everybody, because it isn't really. It's really how you're aging, not about your age. Someone could be 80 or 85 and have all their facilities and be really clear. And other people can be, you know, 50 and losing it in a big way already.
Elizabeth Warren. Now, since the beginning of time, you and I have been saying, first Bernie, then Elizabeth Warren. But we want Bernie. How authentic is Elizabeth Warren? Do you have a problem with her? She is supposed to release her new Medicare for All plan. She claims to be on the same page as Bernie. But has she released her own plan yet? Do we know that if she really is on the same exact page as Bernie?
She co-sponsored Bernie's plan, and she defends it every time. And she unlike Kamala Harris, she gets it right and understands what she signed on to and understands what the plan is and supports it. I feel fine about her. Lots and lots of Bernie bros don't. They don't like her. Every time I say something nice about her, someone, you know, yaps back at me in a negative way. But like I've said, I mean, I'd rather have Bernie as president. And if we don't have Bernie and we wind up with Elizabeth Warren, we're going to wind up with the best president since FDR anyway.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Okay. Beto. Now,
not true of Beto, by the way. Speaking of the debate, he did such a horrible job. He brought down the whole idea of gun control in a really bad way with his trying to paint himself as the most progressive person in a very inauthentic way. I was so disappointed.
Thank you.
He was in Congress for quite some time. I didn't hear him bringing up any progressive things. When he joined the New Dems, I called him and I said, Beto, what the hell? Why did you just join the New Dems? And he said, oh, you know, it's not real. I just want to have lunch and hear their perspective on things. It's nothing. But it was something. And he was a typical New Dem. Right now, there's a bill pending, a specific bill that bans the sale of assault weapons. It's a bill by David Cicilline from Rhode Island, a very good congressman. And this is a real bill. It's been co-sponsored by every Democrat in the House except 25. And they now have their first Republican co-sponsor as well, Peter King from Long Island. Hmm. They have several Republicans who have said they will vote for it, but they don't want to co-sponsor it, but that they would vote for it. And yet Nancy Pelosi is trying to kill it. and isn't letting it out of the Senate Judiciary Committee and onto the floor because she knows it'll pass, and she feels that that will be an embarrassment to a few of who? Blue Dogs and New Dems. In other words, Beto's compatriots who don't want to vote for it. Some of his friends. And Beto, who really never did a thing in Congress, he didn't do anything good, he didn't do anything bad, he just didn't do anything. Now he's on stage and he's trying to make out like he's, you know, the bee's knees, and he's going to go further to the left than everybody else and get a lot of attention. Well, if we can't even pass a sales ban, what the hell is he talking about, saying that we're going to, you know, go into people's homes and take away their guns? That's insane. That is crazy. Maybe someday. But how about a sales ban first? How about voluntary buybacks after that? Maybe years down the road, we could talk about other things. But to bring that up now was horrific.
I agree.
The right-wing media pounced on it. They're now labeling the Democratic Party as the party that wants to come to your homes. They're showing videos of him saying this thing. Yeah, he's an idiot. He is an idiot. He is a selfish idiot. He should drop
yes.
out of this race.
Yes.
He should apologize. And by the way, he's tried to walk back this thing ineptly and hasn't succeeded. But he should drop out of the presidential race. And you know what? You know what's really a shame? He's now not even fit to run for Senate from Texas,
right.
which is what everybody wanted.
Right.
He just screwed up his whole career.
Yeah.
And I don't care about that as much as I feel like he screwed up both the Democratic Party a little bit and the whole fight against assault weapons by jumping ahead of the gun. It's just awful. And of course, a lot of people loved it, and people get angry with me for taking another perspective on it. But, you know, this is a very, very, very touchy issue. For a lot of people, this is the issue that's going to make all the difference on how they vote. And even for people who can accept the idea of banning the sales of assault weapons, they cannot bear to think that the government is going to bust down your door and search your home and take away your assault weapons. And you know, there is no reason to go there. He did it for his own opportunistic gain,
yes.
and it didn't get him.
Yes. Thank you for articulating how much and why I should hate Beto. It was selfish. You know, first he says fuck and everybody, I'm a rock star. I say fuck. He had a tweet yesterday with the word shit in it. And when you don't have policy, you resort to vulgarity. He's not a policy wonk the way Elizabeth Warren and Bernie are. Before Bernie and Elizabeth introduce major pieces of legislation, they examine all sides. They have They're able
How about
to-
they work for a decade, 2 decades? In Bernie's case, he put out this rent control bill, which he started working on when he was the mayor of Burlington back
right.
in the Stone Age.
Right.
I mean, that's the thing. These people are really into policy, and they work on it. You take someone like Kamala Harris. You know, she doesn't even know what this stuff is.
Mm-hmm.
She's a fucking idiot. Sorry for my language. She's
mm-hmm.
another idiot. Just
yeah.
comes up with stuff. It's meaningless.
Yeah.
It's just meaningless. She doesn't mean anything. Her and Beto should hold hands, get up in front of a microphone and say, we made a mistake. We're not fit to be running for president at this time. We'll watch and pay attention, and maybe we'll run some other time.
Right.
At least she should say that. Beto should just get another job.
I did a tirade over the weekend, not as good as yours, about Beto talking about confiscating the AR-15s. And somebody said to me, well, that's, you know, that's bold. You know, you say we need a revolution and you love Bernie. And I said, Bernie has a plan, Medicare for all, and it's well thought out and you can't argue against it. The only way you can win the argument against Medicare for all is by lying. That's how good his plan is. Beto's thing about, hell yeah, we're going to come and get your, it was just self-serving and it's all about me. I'm a rock star. Aren't I cute? I always hated this guy. Did he ever do it?
And he's always been a friend of mine. I've liked him, but I'd like to see him go to one of his 25 friends in the Democratic Party in Congress and say to, well, they're not all his friends, but a lot of them are, and say to them, hey, you ought to sign on as a co-sponsor to this sales ban. He could do that. Some of these guys literally are his pals.
Right.
I'll tell you something. Julian Castro's twin brother, Joaquin Castro, is another new Dem who didn't sign on to it. And I don't want to brag here, but I started yelling it. And I don't know if this is really what did it, but I directly yelled at Julian Castro, who was talking about gun safety. And I said, how about your brother? I'll give you till Friday to get him to sign on to this thing. And he did it.
Good. Good.
Yes, I thought so, too. I like Julian. I do. I really not. He's not my kind of guy. I don't want to see. I know him a little bit. Just a little. I don't want to see him as president, but I think he's a good guy. I think he's, you know, got some ways, some stuff to learn. But I also have seen him learning over the years and getting better over the years. I like that. Mm-hmm. And I feel it's for real.
Yeah.
So my feelings about Julian Castro are positive. And if President Sanders wants to give him a job, I'm all for it.
And I'm glad you said that Biden was wrong, that he had contradicted himself, because the conventional wisdom now, the narrative that the mainstream media is pushing, is that Castro was disrespectful and that Biden had not misspoken. I've gone back and tried to decipher what Biden was trying to say, and it was impossible. I mean, the guy can't put a sentence together.
And his default position is always to lie, which is what he does all the time. He doesn't lie as much as Trump, but he lies more than any other politician in the known universe. And you don't know what he's saying. He's babbling, you know, different things, and you don't know what he's talking about. But he just keeps lying about Medicare for All. I honestly do not think he understands what Medicare for All is. And you know what? I don't even think he understands what Medicare is. I honestly don't think he knows what it is. No one does until you experience. You have to experience Medicare to know what an incredibly great system it is. And none of these politicians ever do.
He can't last.
They have their own thing.
He can't last till Iowa, can he?
I'm not going to say, what his mortality is.
And by the way, Beto comes from, he doesn't necessarily come from money, but he married a wealthy daughter.
He does come from money and more money once he married the wealthy daughter.
Who's a Republican?
His in-laws are Republicans, yes. And they have pretty much paid for his political career in a very, very big way. They and their friends have underwritten him tremendously. Lots and lots of money. And you look up some of these names, and then you look to see who else they donated to, and you see, well, isn't that funny? They just donated a maximum contribution to Beto, and every other contribution they've made in their entire life has been to a Republican, never one Democrat. So that sort of tells you a little bit about who gives money to Beto. Remember, he comes from the city council of El Paso, and he did a lot of gerrymandering and made a lot of working people very, very angry with the policies that he passed. Having lied to them when they elected him, and he was always the darling of the developers. Some of them are Democrats, and most of them are Republicans, and all of them are very wealthy, and all of them have given and can still give money to his career.
Yeah. As a stand-up comedian, I got into a lot of trouble with younger comics because I would not allow my opening acts to say fuck. And it got into...
Save it for yourself?
No, I don't want, for me, on my shows, I don't want to hear comedians use the word fuck, because I knew that the comedians were only saying fuck to punch up weak cheese. And I used to say to them, I work at HBO where we can say fuck, and the way it works is we save our fucks for the weakest jokes. The only reason you're saying fuck is not to be edgy. It's because you have material that isn't up to snuff. And when you.
Wow.
Yeah. And it's true. And
that's interesting, because we have a mutual friend who could barely open his mouth without saying fuck, a comedian named Bobby Slayton.
Well, Bobby's different. Bobby's completely different. But for the most
part. He is so different.
Yeah. 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 And when Beto introduced fuck and shit into the political lexicon, I mean, even Trump hasn't done that. He says, well, not really. I don't think Trump has said fuck. I thought, you know, when you're short on policy, just like a bad comedian, you resort to the F-bomb. So it just reinforced what I always thought about cursing. I mean, you're free to curse. It just says a lot about you. It says that you're not really thinking that much.
Or you're not controlling your emotions sometimes. That happens too.
Yeah. But you're listening to your stupid advisors who are saying, this is your thing, Beto. Keep cursing. You found your way in. Because you know somebody's whispering in his ear saying, this works for you.
Maybe not the first time, but yes, eventually that was definitely a decision they made to do it. And if I remember correctly, I think it was an official campaign T-shirt, right? They did make T-shirts that say fuck on it.
I think you're right. And we're all going to say...
There definitely are T-shirts that say, you know, with Beto T-shirts that say fuck. I'm not 100% sure that they came from his campaign, but I think they are.
Okay. Before you go, I want to ask you two more questions. One is, you've been writing about the distinct possibility that Donald Trump, when he loses in 2020, won't vacate the premises.
Well, yeah, that's not my theory, and I don't really believe it. I'm just writing that there is a theory out there. And, you know, it's an interesting one to talk about and think about. I wouldn't be completely shocked if he tried it. I don't see him succeeding at that kind of thing. I think that they would drag him out by the scuff of the neck. But, you know, who knows? Anything could happen. I don't think he cares about the country enough. You know, even Nixon cared about the country enough to try to make sure there would be no civil war. I mean, that's saying a lot. I don't think Trump would give a damn.
Right. And you also write, with 14 months to go before he leaves, he will stop at nothing to win in November.
Yeah, I absolutely am certain of that.
Okay. Before you go. The Working Families Party. Who is the Working Families
Party? Yes, my friends, the Working Families Party.
Who are they?
They used to be a union-backed alternative to the Democratic Party in New York. And in New York, and unlike some states, you're allowed to do this thing, there's an actual term for it, where you can put your votes together from different parties and they add up to, that you can add them up and get a total, and that's your vote. So in other words, in New York, if you get 10 votes as a Democrat and the other guy gets 10 votes as a Republican and the other guy then gets one vote as a conservative and you get two votes on the Working Families Party, you have 12 and he has 11 and you win.
Mm-hmm.
And not all states allow that.
Like, for example, right. I think Mayor Lindsay ran as both a Republican and part of the Liberal Party. Yeah.
That's right. So the
rent is too damn high. Is that who the Working Families Party gave us?
Who?
Remember the guy who said the rent is too damn high? Like 15 years ago or 10 years ago, was he?
Oh, I remember him saying that, but I kind of gathered he was like some funny guy. I don't know that it came from them. They maybe adopted it or something.
Okay.
I think that was a legitimate expression from some guy who felt the rent was too damn high.
Right.
They were always a union-backed operation. And you get a funny thing with unions. You know, they have a tendency to make a deal with Democrats who are in power. So, you know, like someone like Cuomo, for example. You know, there's nothing that can point to Cuomo, the younger Andrew Cuomo, being a progressive or a liberal, not much anyway, and yet he has managed to co-opt on some level the Working Families Party. Mm-hmm. So the reason that the Working Families Party is in the news today is because they just announced who they were endorsing for president. Now, before I tell you the news, if you don't already know it, last year when they announced that Bernie was the nominee of the party, they released the numbers of votes.
You mean in 2016?
What did I say? Last year? I meant last cycle.
Okay.
Yeah, in 2016, Bernie was the nominee of the Working Families Party, and they, or the endorsee, and they showed that 87% of their members. So members, remember that word, members, voted for Bernie. 87%. That's gigantic. That means 13% voted for other candidates. 87% voted for Bernie. And the leadership, like some union heads, for example, were somewhat embarrassed by that because they were all supporting Hillary. Mm-hmm. And here's this, the big vote goes to Bernie. And they said, how are we going to, what are we going to do about this in the future? And what they decided to do is that the vote of the members would only count for half of the votes. And the other half of the votes would be from these leadership of the party. In other words, these big union honchos. And the big union honchos do not want Bernie getting this thing. And they just announced today that Elizabeth Warren is the nominee. And a bunch of reporters said, can we see the numbers, please? Like you showed us last year, last cycle. And they said, no, we're not doing that anymore. You can't see them.
And
so for all we know, Bernie had 99% of the members. And the bosses decided that they're going to overweigh that by all getting together and voting for Elizabeth Warren. It would be absurd for them to vote for Biden because that, you know, there would be a revolution and that would be the end of the Working Families Party. So they went with Elizabeth Warren, who at least is plausible.
And is Bernie going to fight back?
I don't think so. I think he'll just ignore it. It's my guess. But there are lots of Bernie supporters who are denouncing them roundly. I've had my fights with these guys before. Generally, I have some real regard for them, especially outside of the city of New York, or outside of New York, I should say. You know, the Working Families Party in Oregon, for example. They're great people. But, you know, my problem with them goes way, way back to when they just automatically would endorse Steve Israel every time and every awful New York Democratic hack. They would always endorse them. And that got me angry and made me argue with them, sometimes very publicly. And right up until last year, they were still doing it. And, you know, I'm sure they'll do it again this year. They endorse, you know, blue dogs like Anthony Brindisi, who has the worst voting record of tied, worst voting record of any Democrat in Congress. And Max Rose from Staten Island. These are terrible anti-working class conservatives, and yet the Working Families Party is backing them. So I have a little bit of a problem with them that they can't get beyond the fact that they've got to do whatever the Democratic Party bosses tell them to do, which is what they do.
Were you shocked?
They back Cuomo as well.
Yeah, Bernie. You wrote about Bernie in Las Vegas unveiling his plan to fight homelessness. Pretty impressive. I mean, federal rent control.
He hasn't actually unveiled the actual plan. He's talking about the bullet points, and the actual full plan is going to be coming out in another week or so. What he talked about in Las Vegas or in Reno, wherever he was, was very, very, very amazing. It was an amazing plan. And I'm sure that when it's all the details are filled in, it'll be even more incredible, like with all of his other plans.
That you can't raise the rent more than 3% each year. I mean, that's phenomenal.
Yeah, or the amount of inflation.
Yeah. Let me play you, and then I'll let you go. See if you can guess the name of the party. I found a clip. The guy's name was Jimmy McMillan, and he ran against Cuomo in the previous gubernatorial election, not the one that Cynthia Nixon lost. He ran in the primaries.
Allow me to introduce myself. I represent the rent is too damn high party. People are working 8 hours a day and 40 hours a week, or some a third job. Women can't afford to take care of their children, feed their children breakfast, lunch, and dinner. My main job is to provide a roof over your head, food on the table, and money in your pocket. This is politics as usual. Playing a silly game. It is not going to happen. The rent too damn high movement, the people I'm here to represent can't afford to pay their rent. They're being laid off right now as I speak. They can't eat breakfast, lunch, or dinner. Listen, someone's child's stomach just growled. Did you hear it? Got to listen like me.
You know, it's interesting. Are you still there, Howie?
I am. I'm fascinated because my stomach was growling just when he said that.
You know.
Literally. No, literally. Yeah. If someone was listening really closely, they might have heard my stomach growling.
I'm going to let you go, but 5 years ago, he was a joke. The rent is too damn high party, and he was parodied on SNL. Not so funny anymore. I was kind of playing him to have a laugh, and I'm going, no, this is serious stuff. serious stuff. Jimmy McMillan did not get elected governor of New York. Howie Klein is the founder and treasurer of the Blue America PAC, which raises money for progressive candidates and some socialists around America. Read him every day over at Down With Tyranny. Thank you for Jason Butler. Phenomenal.
Oh, Jason's amazing. Jason is running in North Carolina for a Republican-held seat in the 2nd District, and he is a super progressive, I mean super progressive, pastor, and very well spoken, very well organized, knows what he's doing, and we endorsed him, and we hope that he wins and goes to Congress. And you had him on the day before, when Friday, right?
We had him on Friday's show, and the response was phenomenal. It's a great interview. It's really great interview. And we have Rachel Ventura, who's running for Illinois.
Congress 11th. From Chicagoland district, the 11th district. She's running a different kind of situation. She's running against a conservative Democrat, a guy named Bill Foster, who's a new Dem. Another one of these Beto kind of characters.
I looked him up, and I found an old entry from Down With Tyranny. I think it was like 2007, and you were railing against Rahm Emanuel. Apparently, Rahm Emanuel endorsed him and worked with him, and you were hating on this guy 12 years ago because of Rahm Emanuel.
Yes. In fact, I love that while I was banned from Twitter, by the way, you tweeted something about thanking me for helping your listeners understand what a loathsome creature Rahm Emanuel was. And it was so frustrating not to be able to respond for 12 hours. I waited for 12 hours before I could respond.
You taught me to hate, Howie. Before I met you, I didn't know that you were some. I thought, how bad could Rahm Emanuel be?
As bad as they come.
Yep.
Next time, if you remember to ask me, I'll tell you how he and I nearly got into a fist fight.
Okay. Howie Klein, thank you so much. We'll talk to you next week, I hope.
Bye-bye. Thanks.
Bye.